talking about properties of harmonic functions, and mostly we will be talking about mean value formulas. So we will start with a very simple theorem about flux. So suppose we have a domain omega as usual in some n dimensional space in Rn, and domain is such that it has a sufficiently reasonably smooth boundary, and we will be talking about function u of x here n dimensional vector, and u would be C2 functions in the closure of our domain, and its u is harmonic. We assume that u is harmonic, then in this case the flux across the boundary vanishes. So this fact follows from the one of the Green's identities that we discussed in lecture 17, and specifically it was formula number 2. And here I just copied this formula. It tells us that flux across the boundary equals integral over the volume of this domain of delta u dx, and u here is just a C2 function in omega, function that has second order continuous derivatives in omega. And now if in addition we are given that our function u is harmonic, if u is harmonic then this is zero, and so the entire integral is zero, so this integral is also zero. So very simple proof. And this formula has a physical interpretation in Rn and R3, that if we think of function u as a stationary temperature field and about omega some homogeneous isotropic volume, then this integral multiplied by a given constant can be interpreted as a heat flux across the surface. And then in this case our theorem has very simple meaning, that the flux across the boundary the flux across the boundary of a stationary temperature field in the domain omega just vanishes. Formula 1 illustrates the following a remarkable fact. So let's look at domain omega and take two numbers, rho 1 and rho 2, and assuming that rho 2 is bigger than rho 1. And in this domain omega, let's consider two balls with radius, one of them with radius rho 1 and one with radius rho 2. So somewhere here, and centered at point x sub 0. So here our point x sub 0, here is one ball of radius rho 1, and here is the other ball with radius rho 2. So I'm talking about an n-dimensional case, but I will make this illustration in a two-dimensional case, right? Since it's easier for me to draw a picture. So we have two balls. So ball B1 and ball B2. And also let's think of function u as our let's take u as function u, we will take our fundamental solution phi, right? So here I just remind you the formula, and Now let's look at this region between these two walls. This region, right? And let's write down this formula. So what it tells us that we have to take the integral along the boundary, and nu, we think about nu as an outward normal. So if we were in two-dimensional space, we would say that that would be a boundary of our ball 2, let's call it S2, and we will go counterclockwise like in calculus, and then outward normal nu 2 would be normal in this direction. And to have a properly oriented boundary, so we have to go here in this direction clockwise. So we can call it S1, say, minus S2 plus, and then outward normal would be towards point x sub 0. So that would be nu 1. So, and then we can write formula 1 in this form, that integral along S1 in the clockwise direction plus integral along S2 in the counterclockwise direction with corresponding choice of outward normals is equal to 0. And then by moving one of the integrals into the other side, say this one, and changing direction in, say, counterclockwise direction, and changing nu as a normal facing from center outside, we can see that the flux across flux of phi, right, our fundamental solution across any surface would be the same, would be constant. It does not depend on the radius of our ball centered at point x sub 0. So in this case, we can give the following interpretation. We can think of point x sub 0 as say a heat source of heat, and function negative phi will describe our temperature field. And we mentioned that flux would be the same, and we can actually even compute this flux, what it will be if we take just any ball of radius rho, and we know that d phi d nu would be the same as if we use notations that we used before. We called V of R, and where R is obviously distance from x sub 0 to point x, and then we will see that d phi d nu can be easily computed. And since we are integrating over the sphere with a fixed radius, so this can be pulled out, and then we will see that we end up with the integral which just computes the surface area of our ball, which would be the area of a unit unit sphere, right, in the of the corresponding dimension times radius of that sphere to the n minus 1, right? So surface area of the sphere, and that's what we had before, so everything will be cancelled out, and the integral would be equal 1. So this was the property that we got from formula number 1. Okay, so let's talk about one of the mean value theorem and about spherical mean value. Let's discuss spherical mean value property. So we will be talking about harmonic function, right? So U is a harmonic function, and we will consider this harmonic function in a ball. Ball would be centered at point x zero, and this is r is radius of that ball. And we assume that function is harmonic, and at least on the boundary it is of this ball, it is at least continuous. And in that case, the following formula holds. So value of our harmonic function u at the center of the ball equals to the integral of this function over the boundary of this ball, over the sphere of radius r. So let's just discuss the proof. This formula can be easily seen if we use the representation for harmonic functions that's been proven in lecture 18. So in that lecture we had that for function u that is C2 in the closure of omega, and u is also harmonic, we have the following representation. So u at point x sub 0 was equal integral along the boundary omega, and this formula involved u and our fundamental solution, it's and their normal derivatives. So now let's look at this formula and then rewrite this formula for a ball, but not for this ball, for a ball of radius rho, where rho is smaller than r. So take a little bit smaller ball that is centered at the same point x naught. And so I wrote this formula here. So in this case, the boundary of our domain omega, so omega itself would be this ball, and the boundary would be sphere of radius rho. So we have this formula rewritten here. So u d phi d nu minus phi d u d nu. And then now let's look at the first term here. We just computed normal derivative just a minute ago of phi when we were thinking of phi as a v of r, and that derivative is here. So first integral can be rewritten in this form, integral of this first term. And the second term, if we think of phi as a function vr, so and now this function, when we integrate along a sphere of fixed radius, so then it can be pulled out, so this is why I put it here, v rho. And now we can easily see that if phi can be pulled out, then here we just have integral du, and according to theorem 1, so this integral goes to 0 due to theorem 1. And then what's left? So let me rewrite this formula. So u at point x naught equals to, then this also, just again, r doesn't change, r equals rho, so this can be pulled out. So we have 1 over omega n rho to the n minus 1, and then we have just integral over the sphere of radius rho of our function u. And this is, this looks almost in the way we want it to be. We just need to compute the limit when rho approaches r, approaches our biggest ball, and then we will have an integral over this sphere of radius capital R, which is the boundary of our ball. So this proves the theorem. So let's make a comment about the theorem we just proved. So if we look at this right hand side, this integral, it has a special name. So here I put it, if we have for any function, it's not necessarily harmonic function, for any function f, if we have 1 over surface area of the sphere times integral over the sphere of a function f, it's called the average of function f over the sphere, such an integral. And there is a special notation, so in some textbooks you may see this notation. When you have integral and some short line here, and integral, of course, over the ball, this integral called average of a function boundary of the ball over the sphere. And from that point of view, we can say that theorem 2 declares that function u at the point x naught equals average of function u over the sphere centered at point x naught and sphere of radius r. So there is a similar theorem to the one that we just discussed, at, that states that u at x naught equals average over the ball, the entire ball, not only over the sphere. So that reads like, if you have a function u that is a harmonic function in the ball and at least continuous on the boundary of this ball, on the sphere, and u is harmonic, then u at x naught equals to 1 over this constant times integral over the entire ball of our function u. And the integral that we have in the right hand side is called average of function u over the ball. So here is some sort of definition. If we have this expression for any function f, then we use this notation with the small line across the integral, and that is called average of function f over the ball. And here this kappa rho n is the volume of a ball of radius rho, and just kappa n is the volume of a ball of radius 1 in this space Rn. And here is just a formula. It is expressed in terms of gamma function. Let's recall that in lecture 15 we defined the surface area of a sphere of radius 1 also in terms of a gamma function. So we can find an expression for this kappa for volume of a unit ball in terms of the surface area if we use this known formula for gamma function. So actually, so gamma of x when x plus 1 equals x of times gamma of x. Right, so if we use this formula and if we can rewrite this kappa n changing gamma at n half n plus 1 using this formula, and then we can see that kappa n equals omega n over n. Right, this was just a comment, and now let's go through this simplest short proof. So when we were proving theorem 2, in the very end of this theorem, we had this formula that u at the center of the sphere was equal to the average on this sphere. So let's give it a name, it's formula number 2, and then we start with this formula. If we take this formula and multiply both left and right hand side by omega n rho n minus 1, and then integrate with respect to rho from 0 to r. So let's write this, what we have, u at no, x naught, we multiply, we integrate, and in the same we do in the right hand side, we multiply by omega n rho n minus 1, so this will be cancelled, and then we integrate from 0 to r, the integral that we had before, and then what we have here in the left hand side. So when we integrate rho to the n minus 1, it will be rho to the m antiderivative, then we plug capital R, so we will have omega n r to the n, and so of course it will be rho to the n over n, right? So that's what we will have after the integration, and we can see that if we go up here, that would be equals to kappa n. So in the left hand side, as a result, we will have u at x naught times kappa n. And in the right hand side, when we integrate here over the sphere, and in addition we integrate with respect to rho from 0 to r, that will result in the integration over the entire ball centered point x naught of radius r. So finally, what we have is u at x naught times kappa n and times r to the n equals to this integral. And if we just divide by kappa n and rn, we will arrive at this formula. So this finishes the proof. Let's look at another theorem, which in Evans' book is called converse to mean value property. So let's look at the function, which is C2 in some domain omega, and assume that this function satisfies to this property u at point x naught equals to the average on the sphere, and that holds for each ball in omega. So sphere here is the boundary of this ball. And then in this case, if it holds for each ball, then U is harmonic. So before discussing the proof, let's do some auxiliary computations. So first let's look at the right hand side of this integral that we have here. And let's call this function h of rho. So let's look at this function as a function of variable rho. So here is h of rho, and we can rewrite that this is the average over the sphere. Just we introduced these notations, and then what we need to do, we want to differentiate this function with respect to rho. But to make it more convenient, let's do the change of variables. So here we had a sphere centered at point x naught of radius rho, and now let's move this sphere to the move the center to the origin origin, and then do rescaling. So let's make a sphere centered at the origin of radius 1, and this substitution will do the job. So and then we will compute the derivative. So when we want to differentiate this function with respect to rho, and then we have this function u, x's and y's here are vectors, right? So the first component will be x1 naught plus rho y1, and x2 naught plus rho y2, and so on. And then we want to differentiate with respect to rho. We need to use the chain rule, so it will be the gradient of function u times vector y, and then it will be a dot product of this. And after differentiation is done, we will go back to our old variables. And by the way, I put here sx, remembering that here I am thinking about area of in variables x, and here I put sy, remembering that area is computed in variables y. Then we will go back, we will get rid of y's, we still have this dot product, and this dot product will be, of course, it will be gradient, and then here x minus x naught over rho, it will be a unit normal. So the whole thing will give us directional derivative in the direction of the normal, so it will be just du d nu. And then I just got rid of these average integral notations to our regular integral. And then at this point, we can apply Green's formula, one of the Green's identity formula number two that we discussed in the beginning of this lecture. And so from integral of normal derivative over the sphere, we go to integral over the ball of Laplacian of U. So this was kind of auxiliary computation. So now let's go to the proof. Okay, so what do we have here? We have that U is a C2 function in some domain omega, and for each ball in this domain omega, this formula holds, then U is harmonic. Right? So let's assume for a moment that U is not harmonic. So if U is not harmonic, then exists a ball in omega such that delta U is not zero. If it's not zero, it could be positive or negative. Let's say it's positive for definiteness within this ball. And then let's call this ball centered at point x naught of radius rho. And then we can just use our function h of rho from one side. If we go here, it was given to us that u at x naught equals h of rho. So if h of rho equals u at x naught, then this does not depend on rho, so it is a constant. So h of rho is a constant. Now on the other side, we computed the derivative and we found that derivative equals to this integral. I copied it here. And then if we assume that delta u is not zero and say positive, then this would be positive. So then the derivative of rho is not zero, which means that derivative of h of rho is not zero, which means that function itself is not a constant. So we got, from one point of view, we got that consideration, we got that h of r is constant. From another side, we came that h of r is not constant, and this is a contradiction, which is finished the proof.